Now, on to William Woollard reports on the exciting closing stages of the Lombard RAC Rally.
We have a new World Rally Champion tonight, Juha Kankkonen. The brilliant Finnish driver clinched the title with his win in this year's Lombard RAC. Hello and welcome to Rally Headquarters here in Harrogate on the fourth and final day of this year's Lombard RAC. Well, Kankkonen just cruised through those closing stages under no real pressure to become the first man in the history of the sport to win three World Championship titles. And Carlos, who came so close to repeating last year's victory, well, he will surely come again. As for British fans, well, they were promised a great deal on the first 2 days, but that last British win back in 76 seems just to get further and further away. Today, the cars went north into the North Yorkshire Hills. Four special stages, 43 stage miles. We pick up the action on stage 34 in Dalby with Alan Douglas.
Clear, dry weather provided a welcome change in conditions on the classic Yorkshire stage Dalby as Juha Kankkonen made his way to the World Championship title. After the carnage of the day before, he had a clear run to the finish with nothing to cause concern. He began the day with a 3-minute lead over his nearest rival, Kenneth Eriksson, but more important, 6 minutes in hand over the reigning champion, Carlos Sainz, the only man who could stop him taking the title. And as if to confirm his position, he clocked fastest time on the final stage, 2 seconds faster than Sainz. He had an insurance policy in the form of Lancia teammate Frenchman Didier Auriol. He'd been leading the night before but crashed on the final Kielder stage, losing any chance of a top 10 place. So on team orders, he checked in at the time control early to move up the field to accompany Kankkonen and help out if he had trouble. But even then, he set fastest times on 3 of the final day's 4 stages. A repeat performance for 35-year-old Swede Kenneth Eriksson in runner-up position for the second consecutive year. He was one of the few to have a successful run through the Kielder complex. We should have had more stages there, he said. Maybe I would have won. In the Toyota, Carlos Sainz had had a difficult third day with a series of problems. The final day was spent ensuring a finish with a car that wasn't giving the full 100%. But disappointment to lose his world title after a year of success. Timo Salonen, heading for fourth place, completed the final leg at a steady pace, but even he was still occasionally caught out by the slippery conditions. Let's look at it again from the driver's seat. Fifth in the remaining Subaru legacy, Ari Vatanen picked up a few mementos of the Yorkshire stages. He said he'd spent most of the rally getting to know the new car. Frenchman Francois Delacour had his share of problems, including a brush with the North Yorkshire police, but that didn't prevent him securing sixth place on the final day. Veteran Hannu Mikkola has won the event 4 times. He was seventh in the Mazda in spite of an engine misfire. And a stunning performance by Scott Louise Aiken-Walker, top British driver at number 10. It's her best result in the RAC and the first woman to get a top 10 place since Michèle Mouton in 1982. And an even more remarkable result for 23-year-old fellow Scot Robbie Head, just outside the top 10 in a showroom class Group N Cosworth. He'd prepared the car himself and finished the rally ahead of the Group N world champion, Belgian Grégoire de Mevius. Dave Metcalf once again got amazing results from his two-wheel drive Nova GTE, 14th overall and first in class. And hard work for co-driver Ian Grindrod.
Easy right. 120. Easy right, water inside. Into flat crest 70. Flat crest 120.
Here in Dolby Forest in North Yorkshire, the weather changes as quickly as the mechanics change wheels. This mist is coming down really fast. Now, for the last 3 days, the cars have been separated by seconds, but now they're more spread out, and with just three stages to go, there's a fairly relaxed feeling among the drivers. You look a lot brighter than you did last night in the middle of Kielder.
Oh, it was the long road section on the way to Harrogate. I think, you know, it's quite tiring going at 70 miles an hour.
So what are you going to do on these last three stages?
Drive to finish, I think. It's the tactics. There's too many minutes in front for the next person, and we're quite safe behind, so we'll just drive to finish.
What do you think of this morning's rally?
No, this is a nice stage, sis. Three more to go, and I must go very fast because I think so Vatanen, he tried to pass me.
Yes, most of the cars are fairly well separated in the top 10, but Ari Vatanen's only a few seconds behind you.
Yeah, that's my problem for me. Yeah.
So you and Ari are going to give us the race of the morning?
Yeah, I'm sure. Yeah.
How are you this morning?
Oh, I'm all right, thank you. I was hoping that probably we could catch Timo today. Maybe yes, maybe no, but anyhow, the steering pump failed again. Maybe it had dirt from a previous broken pump, so that was not to be. But anyway, I don't have a world championship at stake, so it's not so serious.
You're getting the star treatment here, Richard.
Well, that's right. The thing is, I've got a drive to match it now.
But you're driving very well, aren't you?
That's right. We're up to 17th place now. I think one of the cars in front of us has just had a problem in the stage, so maybe another place yet.
So everything's gone according to plan?
Yep, no problems at all this morning.
In fact, 20-year-old Richard, runner-up in the Shell Rally Scholarship, was 16th from a start number of 59. The top Czech driver, Pavel Sabira, 20th overall, giving the Skoda its 18th class win in 19 years. Richard Studley's Peugeot car 112 began life as a reps car. In our rally preview programme, he said he would finish in the top 50. He was right, 47th overall. Richard Moore had all his spares, tyres and wheels stolen the night before the rally. With equipment donated by motor clubs, he almost made it to the finish. His engine blew three stages from the end. The youngest driver, Radio Times Rally Quest winner Francine Bogg, started last and finished 68th. The all-woman crew of Penny Mallory and Sue Mead took equality a stage further, supported by a team of female mechanics. And Rudy Lancaster, in his first international rally, won the newcomer's prize. But it wasn't his first honour. He's a former Mr. Woolacombe Bay of 1985.
Right, Juha, congratulations. Fantastic. World champion and winner of the Lombard RAC.
Thank you. I don't still know. The feeling is a little bit like that, but I think it will be better after. But fantastic feeling.
How hard has this rally been?
It has been hard enough, let's say, and we have had every different kind of conditions except snow this time, but difficult and hard and long enough.
And how did it compare with all the other rallies of the world this year?
This is one of the hardest.
And so this year's champion receives his honours. This man has won so many trophies in his 13 years in top-class rallying. This is his 14th championship victory, his third world championship title in 6 years, which says something about his domination of the sport. Greatly aided, of course, by the reliability of the Lanciers. They just seem to keep on going, and all around them are breaking down. And here's the man who lost the title, mainly, it has to be said, because his head gasket blew in Kielder last night. We shouldn't forget that at 29, he's only been in top-class rallying for 4 years, and already he's got a remarkable record. 9 championship wins in just 37 starts. But he had this year's title almost in his grasp. He'll be a sad man tonight. Well, it's not often I get two visitors in this little cubbyhole of mine, but tonight, in addition to Russell Brooks, we've got our own Tony Mason, fresh back from the forest, you might say. Tony, let me come to you first. That incident at McCrae Corner yesterday, when there were spectators all over the road for about 12 minutes trying to help him get back on the road, cars whizzing past a few feet away, seemed very dangerous. Should the rally have been stopped?
Oh, no, I don't think it shouldn't be stopped. This does happen in rallying all the time. And usually marshals go down the track to slow the cars. It is a fairly regular happening.
But can you think, Russell, of any other motorsport where something as dangerous as that could be allowed to occur?
Now, you've got to understand the drivers have got to cope with the unexpected. I think Stig Blomqvist kept going a bit hard, but it was probably more dangerous on television than it was in real life there, so I don't think it was too bad.
But there were about 40 spectators right in the firing line.
Sure, but the drivers knew about it, I'm sure. There was a red triangle out. I'm sure the marshals would have warned the drivers coming up the track. There's no real problem, you know.
Tony, back to you. All these rallies seem to acquire a different character. Last year, for example, it was the skating rink. Mm-hmm. Will this year go down as perhaps the mud bath?
Yes, you can say that again. I've been all around the route, and most of the time I've been up to my knees in mud. So for next year, I'm going to get a set of Wellington boots.
Put them on expenses, Tony. You've been, Russell, chasing Colin McRae around the country, or dicing with him in the national championships. He's obviously very quick. Is he an up-and-coming international star, do you think?
I think so. It shows you how quick the British Championship is. He's undoubtedly got the speed, and if you've got the speed, he can learn to be more consistent in due course, and then I think he's going to be a real world-class driver. I think we've got one in the making there.
Do you think next year, for example, he might get an even better drive?
Sure, he's with Subaru. The car's very, very good already, and next year, with the technical regulations changing a bit, it's going to be even more competitive. I think he's in the right car, quite frankly.
Tony, your last thought from the rally?
Standing in the mud, of course, in Kiel de Forest, seeing Carlos Sainz arrive when he knew he'd lost his world championship, his face just said everything.
Tony, Russell, thank you very much indeed. Nice working with you. Well, that's all from Rally Report. We hope you've enjoyed the coverage. If you're a rally addict, there is a complete review of the programme here on BBC Two tomorrow evening in the normal Top Gear slot, 8:30 p.m. BBC Two. That's all from us here in Harrogate. Hope you, as I said, enjoyed the coverage. We'll leave you with a few highlights of the last 4 days of Endeavour. Good night.
Continues 100. Flat right continues and tightens 70. Curve pass right 70. Flat left 120. Flat right 100. Flat left 50. Flat right, 70 over bump, 50.